He said question.
No, not right now. I am the chair still. So, Dr. Patti, I recognize you and you will get the first question. But just to very quickly say that Abdul has given an overview of mitigation and response and the sense of the Indian idiosyncrasies that he sees. But I think one significant message that he is giving us is that is this, as opposed to other such possible weapons, there is relatively easier access and relative difficulty in management and control. That's the broader thing. He's given several recommendations. I have some views on this, but I will refrain from that till the end of this. We have come to a Q&A time now. I think we have about 15 minutes or so, and that will give me 3 minutes to wind up this session. We are running a bit late, so can I ask the viewers that you ask a question, prefer a question rather than a comment, and keep it crisp. Please do introduce yourself and your institutional affiliation, and let's keep this going. And if it is okay with the panel, we would take a series of questions first, stick around, and then, and I would also expect that you identify to whom your question is addressed. Let's begin with you, sir, Dr. Patti. And thereafter, Yasin.
Sir, my name is Dr. Sayyidatul Patti. I've just completed a PhD in chemical and biological weapon threat, Pakistan's defense needs, problems, and policy work. Probably I started in 2007. Before that, I was in USA pursuing another PhD, which was not awarded to me from University of Pennsylvania, and that was on the topic of terrorism.
But let's come to the question.
Sir, allow me to make comments, brief comments, and then ask them, because it, I'll not be able to clarify them.
I can give you a minute, that's the maximum I can, but otherwise perhaps you can get in touch with that.
Right.
However, I do note that on any subsequent panel or any next session or seminar, you should come and speak your heart.
Sir, first of all, sir, UN Security Council Resolution 1540, this was a vote to invade Iraq on the pretext of Iraq having chemical and biological weapons, and nothing was wrong. Number two, a new term was introduced called terrorism without having an agreed definition in the UN. And till today, we can label anybody of a terrorist. And Pakistan is the biggest sufferer of terrorist violence. So I would request the whole gathering to address them not as a terrorist, but as non-state. Behaving on, acting on behalf of some state. Then, sir, coming to both the conventions. As far as chemical weapon convention is concerned, sir, it has got routine inspections and challenge inspection and investigation of alleged use as mechanism. However, since last 11 years, no challenge inspection has taken place. However, the last 4 pages, we talk about investigation of alleged use. The OPCW has conducted operations, and UN has backed those operations in Syria on the basis of alleged use.
That's about CWC. This is about BWC. So please,
okay, sir.
Frame your question to this, sir.
As far as biology is concerned, sir, we don't have weapons. It is diseases which can be communicated through humans, agriculture and crops, and animals. There is no weapon required, sir. Whereas, as far as Pakistan is concerned, sir, during my research, I found out that 99.9% of the labs, biological labs, and hospitals in Pakistan do not have a detection facility for biosafety level 3 and biosafety level 4 diseases. What to talk of a response? In absence of having even a detection, we are dependent on the donors. polio vaccine, all the vaccines which are given to our children, they are being donated by somebody. And in Pakistan, Brigadier Amir will bear me out, we don't have a detection. We cannot. Having said that, sir, my question is, both the conventions, they obligate us to develop a viable defense against such weapons. My question is that what are we doing to develop a viable defense in and against biological diseases?
Thank you. Finally, I have your question. And I will declare to which panelists would like to answer this question.
Anybody can answer.
Let's take Dr. Yaz.
I am Dr. Yaz Kamar from Delhi. My question is to Mr. Kamran. So thank you very much. You explained everything from Pakistan perspective. My question is in BWC draft act that was prepared in 2011 and with the joint efforts of the National Task Force, and it was submitted to National Assembly, but as you have said that it is not still passed from the National Assembly. Please kindly, can you guide us, is there some thinking at the national level to update it or again submit it? It is one of the prerequisites for being the member of the BWC. My second question again to Ananda. Well, the 7th review conference, it was decided for proper implementation of Article 10. An assistance and cooperation database was created to, and the state parties were asked to submit their requirement, and the donor was asked that their ISU to match it. Have Pakistan benefited from this matter, sir?
Let me take one more question.
I am Kanapakar, I'm from Pakistan Commission, and I am a member of the Scientific Advisory Board. My question from anyone from the panel, that in case of nuclear attack or in the case of chemical attack, that it is some terrorist activity. But in the case of biological attack, viruses, bacteria, they may be natural, they may be, like dengue. How can we remember that they say it is terrorism? This is one. And I think we should develop this capacity building at the national level that we should at least determine that is it any terrorism that let's use, we have to blame anyone for these horrible attacks. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's just have some answers and then we can take another round.
The question asked by Dr. Bhattar Sayyid Modi, that what in the presence of CWC and BWC, what defensive measures should be initiated at the national level? One, I would say that he, having done his doctorate in threat and response, must be knowing more than me on the subject. So my first recommendation would be that you should make your research paper available at a large scale so that people do try to go through that, your recommendation, your analysis. And then if you say, if you have seen very intently and carefully the recommendations which I have given at the end, the first and the foremost recommendation is to have a policy. A policy on the subject. So if we have a policy, the policy, from that policy, we would say then we have, say, we will be able to strategize, we will be able to plan, and then based on those plans, we have required forces, we will have required equipment, we will have required training facilities, and we will have assigned required responsibility to relevant people. So all these aspects are there. So, in my opinion, those are the major areas where we should respond, organize our defense, say, defense against these weapons. And then, just one or two sentences about what Dr. Sarva asked about, commented that in case of bioagents, it's difficult to assign say point out that it has been, whether it has been a terrorist activity or it has been a natural process or through, say, migration of various birds and such kind of a. Yes, I do agree with you, it is difficult, but it is generally possible when a toxin is used. So then you can really understand that toxins are also part of the, are covered under the BWC. So in some cases you can determine whether it has been a terrorist activity or it has not been. But in many cases it may not be as possible, I agree with you. But we must, in every, in both these situations, we must have response agencies, the labs, trained people, equipment, so that we can mount a response.
I think I will add to it a little. First, I will answer Dr. Farhat's question. In my opinion, I mentioned that it takes 7 to 20 days when the disease appears, so it is difficult. Second, it can be seen whether it is a terrorist attack or not by just getting the genetic of that bacteria or the virus, so you can recognize whether it is a re-emerging bacteria from the previous one, or it is a new one, or it came from somewhere else, it is not from this area. So you can say whether it is intentional or non-intentional by looking at this. So this is the answer to that. And really, it is difficult, but you have to gather this information before you make a decision. Second, coming to the questions, as I have already mentioned, that diseases are the things which we have to control, and for that we have to have a vaccine production properly for every person, which developed countries do, and they have a vaccine banks for everybody. Second, I mentioned about the having the sensitivity of detecting it even in the earlier stage, so having a disease early warning system very effective, so whenever a disease appears, it is informed, it is noted by the health authorities, and it is conveyed, and the genetic information is conveyed by that, so we know from where it is appearing.
Thank you.
To the notion that Resolution 1540 is in response to Iraq, just want to put this record straight, it is not. It is not in relation with the invasion of Iraq in March 2003, it is something else. Thank you.
Yes, 1540 was not the underlying pretext for attacking Iraq. Iraq did violate its treaty obligations, and it did also use chemical weapons against Iran. So there were some justification for that, but I don't think we need to go into that. Yes, BWC Act was presented to the Parliament, and for some unknown reason, they put it on the back burner. Perhaps one of the reasons were that we also learned from our mistakes. Maybe we did not involve all the stakeholders in the formulation process, and when it came up for broader discussions, people realized that it was venturing into their areas and without their opinion being on board. So this time we have reinitiated the process of consultation and a broader process, and we are already working on it. In fact, with the help of NIH, we have already revised the initial draft to reflect the realities of 2018, and now we'll be putting it into broader consultation mechanism. Regarding assistance and cooperation database, yes, there is that database, but most of the assistance offers are not very substantial. They mostly relate to biosafety and security, and biosafety and security assistance, our experience has been that it is provided in isolation. It does not cater to the exact requirements of the developing countries. It caters to the priorities of the donors. So that is where I think developing countries need to have a joint stance, and they should be asking for more cooperation in terms of biotechnology as well. But having said that, beyond the framework of the convention, we should be looking for cooperation at the international level in biosciences.
All right, I will take two, three more questions. We will take them in this order, and then the house will be closed. Now, we'll begin with you, sir. One, two, three, four, and five. I'm closing that.
I'm very blind for giving the permission, sir. My very humble question.
This question is for, you know, for this person.
Not for
Please discuss this during lunch.
I'm Dr. Panikai, Chief of Public Health Laboratories at NIH. And what's one of the questions is add on to what we said earlier, the ministry, through its technical arm, the National Institute of Health, has started the process of integrated disease surveillance and response units. And provincial disease surveillance response units are in place everywhere. And various districts have been selected by the provinces where each and every disease is being documented. And we have set up provincial public health laboratories, and we are working on the one health approach so that taking care of anything, whether from animal, plant, or human origin, is taken care of. And alhamdulillah, at NIH, we do have a BSL-3, so we are ready to go for it. The provincial labs, they will not be having BSL-3 facility, but they will be sending the samples to us, and alhamdulillah, Pakistan is moving fast.
Thank you for that information. That's David, is it? Yeah, you said.
My name is Dr. Saifullah Khan. I'm DDG, BRC, Karachi. My question is about voluntary verification mechanism. Does it has any standard SOPs? Because I actually attended this presentation from a German group. They invited 20 people from developing world, and they were allowed to go visit the lab. But these people were not allowed to go into BSL 3 and 4 lab. So there must be some standard obligations if it is implemented. And second, sir, sensitive information publications, does BWC or our Act of Parliament, our Act which is waiting in the Parliament, does it talk about publication of sensitive information? I'm talking about in relation to synthetic biology, like Spanish flu virus was reconstituted, its genome was published, and anybody sitting in a remote area have access to internet and a computer can create this monster bug in an isolated area. So does these both act, BWC and our act, talk about this publication of sensitive information? And third, universities are actually doing research with joint research with foreign universities. And people are enrolled here, they get the samples from here and go to the outside, and our data and microorganism are going outside there, and nobody's, I mean, even knew it. I think there's a need to write a letter to these universities to sensitize them that this should not go on. Thank you very much.
Thank you. They are very, very important questions. We'll come to the response, but let me take other questions. Yes, lady, you have.
My name is Rubin Ali, and I am a PhD scholar at International Islamic University. My first question is from Mr. Kamran. What are the policy tools which we are following in the Pakistan to control the biological threats? And like after 9/11, the United States transformed its national security policy. What are the policy measures and the tools through which we are countering biological threats? Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is Usama Nizamani, and I'm working as a research consultant with the Islamabad Policy Research Institute. I'm grateful to the gentleman for having answered on some of the mechanisms that have been introduced by NIH. My question is with respect to the master's in public health programs. What is being added in the curriculum at present to address the problem of epidemic diseases and particularly its spread? And similarly, I have a second question, which perhaps is not directly related to the topic, but I suppose Mr. Benori can certainly answer that question. Since India has, in its doctrine, has an element associated with the use of biological weapons and its response of nuclear use condition to it, what do you suppose would be the mechanisms to actually verify that biological weapons were used in the first place by any state to basically allow India to undertake its retaliation? Thank you.
Last question.
Thank you, sir. My name is Muhammad Arif. I want to please. Developing countries should focus more on biotechnology cooperation. But these groups like the Australian ones are actually a group of industrialized countries who want to restrict the transfer of technology to the other. And similarly, article of BWC states not to transfer assist to encourage individuals and you want to manufacture a bioweapon. So these processes are very similar. If you want to prepare a vaccine or antitoxin or antidote, any antibody, the process is very similar, only at a certain point in time. So who will actually determine that one is acquiring that technology or making vaccine or making that?
Thank you. Very, very good question. So let's begin now. I think Dr. Ayers were largely comments on, thank you for those comments because it kind of sets the perspective. But Dr. Saf's question, let's begin with the voluntary method.
Well, you're right that we don't have any mechanism coming with controlling the research basically in the high research institutes and transferring the material from outside Pakistan and bringing it even in. So, I will mention one thing, with the help of Dr. Duffer, we are working on it, and we are suggesting a procedure to the higher education commissions at the university that how to control the research and how to control the materials. So they have to get the approval first for their projects and second they have to get the approval for their research publications. So in that way, we are introducing their code of ethics, code of conduct, and code of controlling the research and things like that. And we have done a first survey of the university and have conveyed the message to them. And now we are in a process in which we have made some points available to them to act on and come back to us to inform us that what they are doing so we can give them the guidance according to that. So that is very important, and we have done, we have taken a first step of this, in this direction. And I think in the future, maybe in 6 months, 7 months, Dr. Zafar, maybe in a good position, you mentioned that we will be ready to implement those things.
Could you take the other questions?
I'll respond to two or three points that have been raised. One is on sensitive information about publications, etc., by Dr. Sarah was raised. Now, this particular aspect, which is sharing of information, knowledge, technology, now, this has been defined in the Act of 2004, the Strategic Export Control Act, or the Rustapura nomenclature, the Madalan. Long nomenclature, anything that is related to nuclear, biological weapons, their delivery systems, etc. And this act was passed in 2004. So this covers this technology side and the information sharing that includes in tangible forms or in intangible forms, both. And also
the medium, whether tangible means of use or intangible means of use for transferring, communicating that knowledge or information. So those aspects are actually covered. Then we have, as part of the licensing regime that Media Export Control Division has set up, we have license review committee, which has representatives from, and the committee has been notified in the Gazette of Pakistan. It has people from the relevant ministries and departments, and once there is that license decision, it has to be taken. The committee is convened, and through consensus, the decision is taken. Now, again, this is linked to one of the issues that you also raised about the samples that are being sent out. So the samples, if they contain viruses, bacteria, or fungi that are mentioned in the control list, are subject to licensing, and we have dealt with few cases. They were discussed in the license review committee, and we found out in my presentation, I talked about lack of information, especially to the researchers, and in those cases where joint research is undertaken, the researchers or the people engaged in joint research, they are not actually aware about seeking clearance or NOC from the biosafety committee, the institutional biosafety committee, and then they are required to share the sign-up.